And after that, 10 years. And I remember 2008, sir, we overtook National School Bangalore in terms of ranking. Nalsar Hyderabad was at number one. Justice Bhandari, who is the Honorable Chief Justice of the Honorary Judge of the International Court of Justice, came to Hyderabad when Justice Singhvi was Chief Justice, came and said, "Why are you here now?" I said, "Why, sir?" He said, "You have overtaken Bangalore, your agenda is complete, why don't you come to Delhi? You leave this place now." I said, "Sir, it's very convincing. Coming from a judge, I will seriously consider it." And so, here I am in Delhi. 2008, I came to Delhi. I have already done my 10 years. And students, often people ask me, "When are you going to retire?" I often jokingly say, "I have no intentions to retire." With this background, it's a great pleasure for me to be with my Chancellor, the Chief Justice of the Delhi High Court, and with Mr. Vishwanath, the Senior Advocate, Supreme Court of India, Mr. Venkat Ramani. We have very fond memories of being the member of the 19th Law Commission of India, and we did a lot of good work. Mr. Siv Kumar, I don't know how long we have been friends, and we have a very strong mutual appreciation society. So if I say a lot of good things about him or he says about me, that means we are best of friends. And we say all good things. Mr. Manohar, of course, putting all these things in place, and he was after me to be to again visit this place after 15 years. I promise I'll keep coming now quite often. And then Dr. Lisa is no new to me. We meet in different forums. Thank you very much, everybody, the faculty, the students, the participating teams. Best of luck to you. I often ask, when we have the institutions like this and we have law schools, what is our mandate? And our mandate is to produce a generation of lawyers. Listen carefully what I say. I'm going to ask you, what does that mean? Teachers have a bad habit of asking questions, you know. So our three mandates are that we produce generation of lawyers, those who are technically sound, right? We also produce a generation of lawyers, those who are professionally competent. And we also, most importantly for me, we also produce a generation of lawyers, those who are socially relevant. Let me explain that. When I say technically sound, by that mean you interface now. This is a 21st century. The lawyers of today understand the interface between IT and law. And now beyond IT, artificial intelligence and law. World is going to change. Tomorrow is not the same. World is changing very fast. So all these law schools have to cope up not only with IT and law, but also the disruption in every field, including law, done by the artificial intelligence. Second is the professionally competent. You acquire all those skills of good lawyering. Writing, speaking, research, body language, all those things you start learning through your classes and through the moot court activity. And third, which I said most important for me, is that we produce generation of lawyers that are socially relevant. Not that you become only good lawyers, earn a lot of money. Do it. Nobody says that don't earn a lot of money. Do it. But at the same time, be good human beings. That's why we have four clinical courses teaching you Legal Day, Lok Adalats, that we say adopt villages, have legal awareness education programs, and also internship, like you should intensive with the NGO, so that you say you find out what are the problems faced by the society. Unless you have that connect with the society, understand what are their problems, and get sensitized that what as an advocate, how can I make a difference in the lives of the people. That's what I mean by socially relevant. I started noting down why we have moots. Is it useful? How useful it is? When I was traveling from Dwarka to this place, 75 kilometers. Exactly, right? And if there's no traffic, it will take almost 2 hours. But fortunately today it did not take much time. Let me tell you why this is important. And I started noting down what qualities it will imbibe in students of law. This is a long list, but I'll cut that list short. First is self-confidence. When you participate in a moot court competition, you develop a kind of self-confidence. So we are preparing you to be future lawyers. So when you develop that self-confidence through moots in institutions, when you participate, when tomorrow you go to the court, that self-confidence is very, very important. Sometime the honorable judge will say, you go for, and your senior will say, go adjournment le lena, koi baat nahi, taiyari nahi hai to. And some judge sitting there will say, no, don't take adjournment. You know the facts, argue. Then you have that confidence. And if you know the facts and you argue, most of the time I have seen younger people are given relief by the courts. Many times they are given relief by the courts, and that motivates you, gives you that confidence. Second is dealing with stress. I can see the faces. Those who are going to participate, not a single smile on any face. Because immediately after this, the competition is going to start. So second very thing which is very important is you start learning dealing with stress. This is not one time competition at Lloyd. You will be facing this competition every day in, day out, when you go to the courts. So if you don't learn coping with the stress, your life would be miserable. Then probably you need to do that. Setting goals. When do I submit my memorial? What is the last date? When do I reach there? And all those things, you set your goals. Your goals, setting goals is very, very important for moot court problems. Decision making. What kind of line of argument you are going to take? It is very, very central. And then solving problems. What is the problem set by the expert on the moot, and how do I solve the problem? Which side of the fence I'm going to argue? Right? And then what kind of arguments I pick up? Planning. When you do this, you do a lot of planning. And you also sometimes rehearse. My time would be 45 minutes. And you ask your friend, please set your watch. Am I going to finish it within 45 minutes? Or it is going to take more time or less time? You plan accordingly. You can't finish it early. You can't go beyond your time allotted to you. But unfortunately, in the presence of the Chief Justice, I dare say this time management stops here. In courts, there is no time management. In spite of the fact that long back, there was a legislation which said that the argument in the Supreme Court should be concluded within 90 minutes or so. There was something like that. And now that was neutralized by the Supreme Court itself. They said, no, it can go beyond that. And the high courts also followed suit. And then timeline is only for the students, those who participate in the moot courts, not for Justice Mr. Venkatramani or Mr. Nageshwara. It's not there. I wish that timeline would also be imposed on the advocates, those who argue before the High Court, Supreme Courts. That would significantly cut down the delay in cases, significantly cut down the arrears. Then you learn managing time. As I said, managing time is very important. Dealing with criticism. So what you say, the other team will criticize. You have made no argument, your argument is very poor. So you have to also see that. Clear thinking. Your thinking has to be very clear. You can't be confused yourself and confuse the judge also. Judge will say, what are you trying to say? Are you clear? You understand what are you trying to say, you know? So that is very, very important. Identifying resources. When you do that kind of research, where do I find my material? What is my source? Primary source, secondary source, database? You do that kind of research, you know. And you also learn dealing with failures. Not that every time in a court, you win a case. Here also, many of you will win, many of you will lose. So you learn losing a case or enjoy winning a case. Sometimes you win, sometimes you lose. That is also very important. You learn effective speaking. If you are not an effective speaker, if you just can't hear you, every time you say, what are you trying to say? And also effective writing. If you submit some submissions to the court, your writing should be very, very effective. Analytical ability. You should be able to analyze the law. You should be able to analyze the cases. You should have divergent thinking. When you prepare a moot court problem and you argue, you also have to keep in mind what my other party is going to ask me. You have to be ready for those questions, otherwise you face a problem. And then you also apply the learning you have done in your whole time situation. And the most important is honest behavior. You have to have honest behavior when you do it. You can't copy from here and there and then prepare your brief. One of the very famous jurists said, why moot advocacy is important? And within quotes I say, he said, moot court will work, will bring you into quick contact with a group. You work within a group. And in groups of students lies hope of education. In groups work lies the deepening of thought. In groups lies the ideas, cross-light, dispute, practice in dispute, cooperative thinking, and practice in consultation. Spur the weary, pleasure for strong, a threefold cord is not quickly broken. In group work lies salvation. And another very important thing which was said by somebody. Somebody asked Michelangelo, how do you produce so fine statues? Michelangelo ka naam suna na aapne? Unhone se pucha, how do you create so beautiful statues? He said, I do nothing. The stone before me, the only thing I do is I chisel it and bring that fine statue out. So for me, all my students sitting before me, the job of a lawyer, the job of a teacher is to chisel that stone and bring a best of lawyer out of you. Best of luck, best of everything. Thank you very much.